welcome to QI, where tonight we're looking at G4 gravity, assisted by our weighty contestants and, of course, my own gravitas. Distorting space-time for us tonight, we have four massive stars. A gigantic pulsar, Rich Hall. Huge red giant, Bill Bailey. A colossal supernova, Barry Humphries. And a hypothetical black hole, Alan Davis. And tonight, their buzzers are all weighty. Rich goes...
Oh, man.
Weighty, you see, and Barry's goes...
Wait for it! Wait for it!
And Bill goes...
Your weight is 12 stone, 2 pounds, 4 ounces.
You wish.
You wish.
So, sorry.
How dare you?
Sorry.
Oh, it's the new cockiness of the recently spelt.
No. And Alan goes...
Oh, I do, actually.
So, let's drop right in, shall we? My first question is, how can you get from here to anywhere on Earth in exactly 42 minutes and 12 seconds?
Wait for it!
Harry.
I meant to say, I like that tie very
much. Thank you. And coming from a man with your colour sense, that makes me so happy.
I was hoping I wouldn't be overdressed tonight.
42 minutes and 12 seconds. You can get to anywhere.
Through the Earth.
Develop. Develop that thought.
Oh,
it's a theoretical rather than practical.
Burrow, then.
Yes, if you...
Burrowing?
Were... Yeah.
Through the Earth.
Yeah.
Directly.
You'd have to be more vigorous than that.
Well, that's just getting the surface soil off. All right.
Yeah.
Well, there's a start somewhere. You wouldn't start like that, would you?
Well, what speed would you have to go through the Earth to do it in 42 minutes, though?
At the speed that is determined by...
Gravity.
Gravity, by maximum velocity. Yeah, the idea is that if you were to tunnel straight through...
Yeah.
You mean if there was a tube that went through the tunnel that went through and you jumped down it, it would take you 42 minutes to come out the other side.
Exactly.
But would you drop... I'd like it if you dropped straight through and dropped out the other end.
Yeah, you would accelerate all the way to the middle and then you would decelerate out.
So you'd and just make it.
Yeah. You'd be in Australia.
Ah! That's the point I was going to say. Yeah, but actually, you could do the tunnel from London to Moscow. It could go in any sort of section across. That's why I said from anywhere from here. Gravity operates at all angles. It doesn't just operate from the north to the south, as it were.
There's a jump.
So from London to Paris,
to Paris
would be the same length of time.
Yeah, it would indeed. It would have to be the same time.
I dug a tunnel. I could get from here to right there in about 12 seconds.
There you're right.
The other 42 minutes is just.
Yeah.
Waiting for your luggage.
It takes that length.
But the antipodes thing's interesting. An antipode is the exact opposite points on the Earth. They don't have to be north to south. There are antipodes from one part of the equator to the other, obviously. It's the exact, because it's a...
I thought we were New Zealand.
Well, interesting thing is, actually, we're nowhere land.
Oh, we come out of the sea.
And there was a contest to make an Earth sandwich for someone to put... A piece of bread on one part of the Earth, and the others would put the piece of bread on the exact antipode of that. And there are not many choices, oddly enough. So New Zealand was one piece of bread.
Iceland.
Not Iceland. A little further south.
Tewkesbury.
Spain.
Spain is the right answer.
Thank you.
Ah, brilliant. Very good. But there was immediate controversy because they used baguettes, pieces of bread. And so no one was quite sure whether they were oriented in the same direction. So it might have been a cross shape, which would have disqualified it for a sandwich, really. You can't have a sandwich with baguettes crossing, can you?
How do you get to be involved in these competitions?
I fear the answer is you have to be Canadian. There were Canadian brothers who won it. They were called Jonathan and Duncan. But anyway, they could have chosen Indonesia to...
Oh,
America.
You're going sideways. Well, South America, it's Colombia. So not bad, not bad. But one of the most interesting ones, from a practical point of view, if you're a particular kind of religionist, would be the antipode of Mecca. The exact opposite of Mecca, is a tiny little atoll in the South Pacific.
which Christmas
Island.
Tematangi Atoll. It's also known as Captain Bligh's Atoll. So it's, oh, yeah. And there it is. That's actually a photograph, amazingly. That's, it's actually got a huge lagoon in it. Mm. And the great thing is, if you're a Muslim, you could kneel there, you could face any direction, you'd be facing Mecca.
Yeah.
Because it's the antipode. It's rather right. pleasing. And we were talking about the gravity train, weren't we?
Yeah.
The
little, gravity.
The idea of it going
is
through
Is it
the
feasible, then? Did Richard Branson already figure out some way of...
it's not, no, not feasible on Earth. On the Moon, it might be, because the Moon has no molten core. Though, oddly enough, it would be 53
which
minutes.
Which moon are we talking about?
Ah. Oh, there's a sore point. Let's just... our usual friendly moon, the one we look at. But oddly enough, that would be 53 minutes to get through.
What?
Why would it take longer to get through the moon,
which is
so much smaller?
Gravity is so feeble.
Yeah.
Yes, and then just... really, that. What's the point of it, really?
You could get through it like that, though.
Yeah.
Because the antipodes are not that exciting, are they?
No,
really?
The other side
I'm on the moon,
the moon
and I'm on the other side of the moon.
Exactly. What I tell you, though, is interesting, is who do you think worked out the 42 minutes and 12 seconds?
Patrick Moore.
No.
QI researcher.
I know, Alan Titchmarsh. He was digging the garden.
Charlie Dimmock.
Yeah.
Where are they now, eh?
Don't
know. What's so amazing about it was that it was actually a series of letters between Isaac Newton and Robert Hooke in the 17th century. They worked out the exact mathematics, and it's not changed. It's still exactly as true as it was.
You know, like in the film Brazil, where they put things in tubes and they never know where they go.
I love that. Yeah.
Just put it in a tube and it pops out in the Antipodes.
You're too young, young scampy Grace, aren't you, to remember the change machines in shops?
Ah.
You remember those?
Sorry, beautiful. Scampy Grace.
Was it...
it was wonderful.
What was the one in... Gamages, was it? In...
That's right. You gave the money, real money. No yeah. credit cards.
That's it.
And a very nice girl with, in black with B.O. She'd, she took the money...
Yeah.
And she wrapped it in the docket. It was called the docket.
The docket, yes.
Oh, yeah.
And she put it in a cylinder.
Yeah.
And
it
the
looked
cylinder
like a milkshake.
Was immediately put, sucked into some other part of the store.
That's right, it was a vacuum. It was a so you put the fiver in, then put the docket in, which said you've bought something worth £3.07 and 6, and there's the £5, and it would go like that, all that noise, as you say, and then you'd sort of wait there and chat. And
they were subject to abuse, those machines. Yeah.
Perhaps it wasn't B.O. after
knowledge.
All.
Just aren't enough tubes, are there?
There aren't enough tubes in the world. Yeah, just things that work mechanically are kind of larky
yeah,
and
that,
fun.
Yeah, that big sucking sound that you... I would like to know the force that in the airline toilet. I don't know what creates that.
Isn't it?
That is.
Actually,
that's frightening.
I have to cover my ears.
If you, mistimed it, your intestines
your
would
head
be...
down shoot out. If you're sitting on it and you've sealed round the rim...
You would lose your guts.
You can lose your innards.
Yeah.
I've heard of that happening.
Wow.
There's a guy where I live in Montana who... Because we have prairie dogs, and prairie dogs are, like, that big. They're cute. They're, like, a cross between, like, a meerkat and a squirrel, yeah. But they're rodents, and they dig tunnels. And if you don't want to shoot them with a .22, this guy will come around and suck them out with a grain elevator.
Oh.
On the back of a truck. With a big howitzer cannon nozzle, and he knows exactly how many are in the tunnel. He'll go, there's four in that tunnel. And he turns his thing on and goes... amazing sound in the world. And then they come through, and then they have, like, his 80s blow-dry look, right? They just been sucked through at, like, 80 miles per hour. And they're like miniature werewolves, and... I said to him...
So they don't get shredded. It's not like...
No, not shredded.
It's not like just... Steve Buscemi in Fargo.
No, no, no. But they are looking at you like you owe them an explanation. I said to the guy, doesn't this give him brain damage? And he went, yeah, of course. But it doesn't kill him, that's the humane alternative. And I said, what do you do with him and when after you catch him? And he says, I just take him across the river and let him go, and then I wait 3 or 4 days and work that side of the river.
To return to the original question, if you drive a tunnel straight through the Earth, a gravity train would take you where you want to be in exactly 42 minutes and 12 seconds. Aristotle, as I'm sure you all know, thought that heavier objects fell faster than lighter objects. And it seems an intuitive and correct idea, but Galileo worked out that they didn't. And how did he do that?
Wait for it!
He dropped two cannonballs off the Leaning Tower of Pisa.
Ah, Well, did he? Oh. I'm sorry about that, but the reality is that he worked out that this was the case from his head. He then did some experiments with ramps and things that proved it to be true.
What's heavier, a ton of gold or a ton of feathers?
Exactly that kind of thing, if you like. But what he's saying is that... What's that? Half a ton... he's saying half a ton of coal... What Galileo
like
said...
like a sort of Elton John party request, or something. Yeah.
Of course, the answer is that one of them is heavier, isn't there? Because gold is measured in troy weight rather than avoirdupois, and they're different. So a ton of gold is different to a ton of feathers.
Sorry, no, sorry.
Just, I believe. I'm sorry. But what Galileo said was that half a ton of coal falls at the same speed as a ton of coal. That's the point. Falls at the same speed. You know, if you let go at the same time, they'll both hit the ground at the same time.
How can you get a ton of coal up in the air?
Well, indeed. Galileo's reasoning was thusly wise. He said that if you had a heavy object, if you believed Aristotle, yeah, it falls fast, and the lighter one, slow. So suppose you attach the light one to the heavy one. Well, the heavy one falls faster than the light one, so it would make the light one fall faster. Or the light one would hold the heavy one up because it's going slower. That's, so by attaching them together, you would make it go both faster and slower. And that's obviously impossible. The only explanation is that they both travel at the same speed. And he then proved it. And on Apollo 15, Scott, the astronaut, thought he'd try and see if Galileo was right. And we have a clip of him doing it. It's rather wonderful.
And I'll drop the two of them here, and hopefully they'll hit the ground at the same time. How about that?
How about that?
Which proves that Mr. Galileo was correct in his findings.
Isn't that cool? Astronaut David Scott proving Galileo right with a hammer and a feather. But Galileo established it by the power of his own thought. Similarly, Newton worked out the laws of gravitation and published them in 1687, which was just 100 years before Les Frères Montgolfier, the brothers Montgolfier, astounded the world with the first balloon ascents. And that, it was only 1 year after that that dashing old Etonian George Biggin and Letitia Sage were in a hydrogen balloon, and they took off from Southwark. And I want to know, basically, how far did George Biggin go?
Not to Biggin Hill, surely.
Well, I wonder how far did Mr. Biggin... Yes.
All the way.
Hey! Well, oddly enough, that may be the right answer, because it was one of the most extraordinary things you could imagine. A balloon ascent was an astonishing sight, and 150,000 people turned out to see the first one. And this Italian who brought ballooning to England, who was called Lunardi, put these two people in and thought, that's probably too many. So he jumped out just as it was taking off and left this couple on their own, these complete first-time balloonists.
Were they tethered?
No. They took off.
Did they just keep going then?
Well, it became one of the sensations of the age because
Mile High Club, first one.
They were the first members of the Mile High Club, as it were. Yeah. Well, what happened was they were seen as they were going over Piccadilly. She was seen on all fours.
Is it a glass bottom balloon then? Yeah.
She claimed later that she was fastening up the opening of the balloon.
Yeah, that old chestnut.
Yeah.
Me, officer? No, officer. Opening of the balloon, officer.
But they, the technical answer is that they got as far as 14 miles. They got as far as Harrow, shouting down with using a speaking trumpet at people below, who must have been rather astonished. There is slack-jawed yokels from the village of Finchley and other such things or whatever.
Work, you idle buggers!
But there was a great scandal about it, and it became the issue of the age, was whether or not you could do it. And one of the most remarkable social records of that age is the wager books, the betting books of the great London clubs, particularly Brooks's and White's, which were in St. James's, and people used to bet on anything. And the books still exist in the handwriting, and there is one here. Lord Cholmondeley has given 2 guineas to Lord Derby to receive 500 guineas whenever his lordship plays hospitals with a woman in a balloon 1,000 yards from the earth. Four plays hospitals with, I think you can insert your own word. Sorry. You see what I mean. Good. So there you have it.
Yeah. Did he pay up then? Is that in the book?
We don't actually.
1,000 yards. No, you were only 900 yards.
It's true, they had no way of measuring. What did they use for an altimeter, do you imagine?
They dropped things to see how long they took to hit the floor?
No, they used a barometer. Barometers existed. Mm. There was different pressure. So it's quite accurate.
Barometer, it was quite a hefty piece of kit, was it?
Yeah. You had to hang it up and tap it. with the stem of your pipe. Well, as with flight, of course, you know, as soon as a new technology like this emerges, as we saw with aeroplanes later, there are various targets that you want. Be the first person to do this, first person to do that. We've seen the first person to play hospitals on board a balloon, but one of the great things is to cross the...
Channel,
exactly, yes. Across the channel. With aeroplanes...
M25?
Larry, of course, not the M25. But the channel. And the channel was an extraordinary business. It was a Frenchman called Blanchard and his American backer. But they hated each other and they loved their own country. So first the Frenchman. Can you imagine a Frenchman not playing fair? Hard to imagine, but anyway, try and picture it. Had carried lead weights on a sort of belt, this Blanchard, so that he could then claim to the American, oh, there's only room for one of us, unfortunately. I will have to do this record alone. And the American saw the weights and made him take off his ballast. And then they accidentally dropped each other's national flags out of the balloon when they took off. And then the balloon started to drop over the channel too early. And so they threw out their food, they threw out their instruments, then they started to throw out all, obviously, the sandbags. Then they took their jacket off, then they took their trousers off, then they peed and pooed out of the basket because they were approaching the cliffs and they're dropping and dropping and dropping, so they have a poo and they just get over it like that and land in the trees and the record is made.
Yeah. It's not a very dignified way to break a record, though, with your trousers around your ankles.
No.
Hanging out the outer. We've nearly done it. Like, oh, all the press are here to meet us. Oh, dear.
One last push.
Yeah.
Well, anyway, that's Mr. Biggin and Mrs. Sage. They went, as Barry correctly said, all the way from St. George's Fields to Harrow. We won't have any truck with gossip here on QI, of course. So, what do you say to a gossipy boma?
Wait for it!
Mind your own business.
Oh. We predicted that, I'm afraid. You're getting a nice score building up, Barry.
No, it is.
It's good. Gossipy boma.
Boma? What's boma? Is that a creature? Boma.
I know what it is.
Yeah?
It's something a surgeon leaves behind inside you after an operation.
Oh, Barry, that is brilliant. That is the right answer. Brilliant. That's exactly what it is. It's a cotton or lint or piece of sponge or something like that.
Or a mobile phone.
Or indeed a mobile phone. It comes from the Latin for cotton, in fact, gossipy. So it would be like a piece of cotton wool is the most basic one. In America, 1,500 cases a year of things being left inside.
Really?
Yeah.
That's because a lot of them are... a lot of people eat fridge magnets in America. Because they look like cookies or chocolate. And then they cut them open and locked all the tools just... shoot off the tray and...
Yeah. It's a damn good theory. Coins on them.
And they stick to the sides of mobile homes, all kinds of things.
Yeah. 54% of foreign bodies are left in the abdomen or pelvis, 22% in the vagina, 7.5% in the chest, 70% in other places like the spinal canal, brain and face, bizarrely.
In the face?
Didn't they do it for a bet?
What, the surgeons?
Yeah. And then they get more work, don't they, getting it out again?
They probably get sued there, don't they, I'd imagine. There was one chap who had a 6-inch metal surgical clamp taken out, and they realised he'd already had an operation to take out one surgical 6-inch clamp, and he'd had two left in him, and when they took the one out, they never thought to look for another one in there. Extraordinary behaviour.
Train set.
The main risk factors... What would you imagine are the main risk factors? Why is it likely to happen? Because they do. There is a protocol whereby you count all the equipment, so why would it happen?
Well, some of them have an ego, and they, you know, they do good work, and they think, well, I want someone to recognise my work, so I'll leave my forceps in there.
Well, apparently it's emerging...
People go, oh, this is the work of Dr. Bonner. This is clearly a Bonner.
Well, the reason they give is emergency operations that have not been planned properly and unplanned changes in the operation. And patients with higher body mass index. Fat people.
Well, they lose their stuff.
You put it down on the side. It just gets sucked in. I don't know. Is that the...
There's a nurse in there. Thank God you're here.
This is where we need Hugh Laurie on the show, isn't it?
He would explain exactly. He would explain. If the script was put in front of him, he's a gibbering idiot without his...
No, he isn't.
No. There are, in fact, specific words. Yeah, the most common they use is gossipy boma, which originally comes from the fact that it's cotton, because the Latin gossipium is cotton. But if it's a surgical instrument, it's actually called a foreign body granuloma. Yeah. And the cheek of the surgeons is that they call it retaining, as if somehow it's the patient's fault. The patient retained this object while unconscious on a slab. You know, nothing to do with us.
Yes, its pancreas grabbed it.
That's right.
Just wouldn't give it back. Yeah. No choice but to leave it there.
Anyway,
just slightly disturbed by this picture. It's just really disturbing me.
It's like backstage at a puppet theatre. Give me blood puppets, quickly.
Yeah. No, it's a lady with invisible breasts.
Is it?
We like the thought of it. Well, anyway, yes, a gossipy boma is a piece of cotton left inside you by a surgeon. Anyway, what's the use of an underwater weighing machine?
12 stone, 4 ounces.
There you are.
Yeah, yeah. That does it. I weigh a bit less underwater. That's what I'm trying to say.
Speak your weight.
Yeah.
Why would you have an underwater weighing machine?
Whales weighing station.
Oh, the said the whale weighing station. Yeah, this is fabulous. You're thinking along.
Just hope I get the worst marks. Because losing is the new winning.
You're right. I have to say, you're bidding fair.
Don't they weigh your mass body fat by floating you in a tub so you can...
Yeah. And what is a body mass index? Do you remember exactly what it...
Your height divided by your weight, your height squared.
Weight divided by your height squared, yes. Like that. That's, more or less, yes. But it's very faulty. If you're very muscular... Yeah. The BMI would argue that you're overweight and obese and far too fat, and you could in fact be immensely fit. Or also, if you're a marathon runner and you have that slow twitch muscle, as they call it, I think, then you would be starving and be considered, you know, malnutrited or whatever the word is. So when they want to make really, really accurate measurements of body mass index, they go underwater, and it's considered the gold standard for body fat measurement. And what would you say, what percentage fat should you be under not to be obese?
Chubby.
20?
20. Under 20. 20. How did you know that? 20. No, you're fine. No, that's just, it's got a baggy thing.
Yeah.
with women, should women have more body fat or less body fat?
More.
More, exactly.
More, yes.
They can be?
300.
30%. 30%.
I saw one in Budgeons the other day, it was definitely 300. And all she had in her basket was a massive, massive bar of chocolate. That's all she had. Really serious expression on her face.
Now, when I'm in Norfolk, there's nothing I like better than having a good old bicycle around the Broads.
It's that very is pleasant.
I think you and I do it together, don't we? There we are, look. There are such larks we have, don't we?
Hacked again, I can't believe it.
Home in time for lemonade and buns. And isn't it funny, Alan, I said, isn't it funny, the faster I go, the more likely I am to stay stable. But if I go very, very slowly, I wobble and fall off. I wonder why that is. And you said, I know, Stephen, let's make that a question in the next QI episode. Yeah. And so that's what I'm doing. Why, when you slow down, do you become less stable on a bicycle? What is at work? What is the physics
of that? I have a better question. Why do you have a Hitler haircut? Why is Alan wearing a hairnet? Let me just put a little mustache under that nose. That would be frightening.
How come?
I dressed as Hitler once. I did a school play. I played Arturo Uy, you know, the resistible rider Arturo Uy. And I was Uy. And I actually dyed my hair black and cut it in the Hitler style for the authenticity of the role, not because I'm a Nazi or anything. And, and my mum said, oh, now that does look nice. Now that. You look very smart. And I said, I'm supposed to look like Hitler. My mum, God bless her, she couldn't see any fault in anyone. She went, well, you look very smart. You should keep it like that.
Oh, mother's.
Oh, no.
Why do we wobble? I wobble because I'm scared to death when I'm on a bike. I wobble even when I'm going very fast.
Well, what kind of bike is it? Is it a penny farthing, by any chance?
No, it's whatever I can find in the street and hasn't got a locker.
A locker. Was it you?
Yeah. Oh, that happened in Cambridge, didn't it? That was so sad. They tried this nice, noble idea that they would have bikes, city bikes, that have a special number on, and you just saw one leaning on a lamppost, you got on it, and you bicycled to wherever you wanted to be and left it outside, and there were a common exchange of bicycles. All right, it's a perfect socialist dream, a utopian ideal of free bicycles. 2 days, I think it lasted before...
Truck arrived from Oxford.
Yeah, basically. The odd thing about it is bicycles, pretty ancient invention by modern transport standards, but it was only in 1970 that the physics of them was understood.
There's more force working on you if you're going slowly, so you're being pulled from
other
Well, yeah,
side
people thought it was gyroscopic pull or a centrifugal one in some way. But it was demonstrated by a fellow called David Jones in 1970 that, in fact, it's not that. It's torque that lowers the centre of gravity. And the other thing is, it's called the caster effect, like a supermarket trolley. Yeah. The fact that the back wheel is a trailing wheel, it kind of self-centres, it rights the whole thing as it trails along.
I always get the trolley with a stiff wheel, with a wheel.
Oh, they're the ones.
At airports and supermarkets, I always get that trolley.
You get that? Oh, yeah.
I veer into old ladies with it.
Oh, that's
I crash into displays.
Yes.
I do that and blame it on the wheel.
Yeah.
Oh, sorry, bad wheel.
So, here's the thing. If you want to go left, you turn the handlebars of your bike slightly to the right. Motorcyclists know this as a rule, but...
Counter-steering.
Yeah, counter-steering, exactly. It's very, very quick. It's done automatically. People don't know they're doing it. Which is why curbs are so difficult, because if you're close to a curb, in order to steer away from the curb, you have to steer into it first. Just do a little that and then that. Otherwise, you fall over. It's weird. It's an automatic thing that people do. Really strange. Yes. There's a way of testing it. You're coasting along, take your left hand off the right, OK? And you push the handlebars with your right. Now, with this, you can only force the handlebars left, obviously. Yeah?
Yeah.
But you go right. So the reason why bicycles are stabler when they go fast is nothing to do with gyroscopes. It's all to do with torque and castering. When you're cycling, the more revolutions, the better. So imagine it is the revolution. The Red Dawn has come upon us, gentlemen. We've overthrown the hated oppressors, and we're all happy. And we've got guns, so we shoot straight up in the air, as people do. Wee, yee-hi, yee-hi. Is this a good idea? Shall we do that?
Well, I don't know. I've often thought, where do those bullets go?
Yeah.
They come down.
They come down and...
And hit people right on the top of the head.
Does that often happen?
Yes. Unfortunately, it does, because of what goes up, as you know, must come down. And, of course, it won't happen to the guy who shoots, because when it gets to the top, the smallest amount of wind, it will, you know...
It'll go about a mile away.
Yeah, well, not a mile, probably, but they did an experiment on a floating platform where they fired 500 straight up in the air, and only four landed on the platform of the bullets.
Four dead.
The rest splashed. No, I think they covered themselves.
496
tin hats. Yeah, so a typical 7.62-millimetre round, fired vertically, reach a height of... What sort of height do you think?
Half a mile.
Longer.
10 feet. Mile.
2.5 kilometres, nearly.
Straight into the couple, yeah. Shagging in the balloon.
Of course.
Talk about coming full circle. So it would take some 17 seconds and another 40 seconds or so to return to the ground at a speed of about 70 metres a second. So what you're getting is this gigantic thing that will penetrate, smash the skull, very, very dangerous cranial injuries. Here's an interesting thing. You won't believe me. I sort of don't believe it myself, and yet I know it's true. It's one of those things. It's counterintuitive, I think, is the word. In this hand here, I've got a bullet, right? Mm-hmm. In this hand, level with it, I've got a gun. I fire the gun and let go at the same time. Which bullet, that one or that one, hits the ground first?
The one that you drop.
That one?
Mm. Yeah.
No. They both hit the ground at exactly the same time.
Bollocks.
I know! I knew you'd say that. They both have exactly the same force acting on them. Gravity.
Yes, but the momentum will defy gravity, won't it, for a bit?
It will just describe a different thing.
Is that because the speed of the bullet?
Yes. It could go 2 kilometres, that bullet.
But incredibly fast. And then hits the ground. And
I have to do it at the speed of light.
No.
Does this information come from Wikipedia?
I know. are there any scientists here who will back me up on this? Yeah. See? Yes, there's some yeses there.
Any assassins?
It does seem incredible, but it is true.
So you're saying you drop a bullet at what height?
Well, you're standing. Height. You're standing, yeah.
And you fire a bullet, and that bullet from the gun will go into the ground.
They're both at the same level, yeah. I mean, there are things that could stop it happening. If the bullet went 5 miles a second, it would actually leave the atmosphere and obviously never fall to Earth. If it went far enough, the curvature of the Earth would mean that it had further to fall. But assuming the kind of gun where it doesn't have that range, then what I'm saying is true.
Is there any practical application?
Who knows? Well, there's enormous practical applications in the laws of physics that say this must be the case.
Well, no, I mean, I suppose there is. It's a double assassination, isn't it? You kill a person and an ant. It's a source of personal pride to the assassin.
It would, wouldn't it? Yeah.
Offing of some insects.
Exactly. So, if you're going to stop a bullet, the very worst way to do it is with the top of your head. Still, nonetheless, viva la revolución. Let's say we've now entered the city, which we have secured. We've rounded up all the investment bankers, but a small group of them have holed up at the welcome break motorway service station at Scratchwood, which is the first one if you go north out of London on the M1. Yeah. Now, but we, the revolutionary cadre, the compadres, OK, we are in the city of London, OK, but we have to stop them. We've closed down all telecommunications, so we can't, you know, give instructions to other, you know, members of our brigade. We have to stop them from where we are in the city of London, and they're in Scratchwood. How's that going to happen?
Fire something at them.
Yes.
Ginster's pasty.
Got them. This is just a bizarre fact. Without knowing it, they've chosen the one place to get to where you can get to them with a gun that exists here, now, today, not far from this studio. We're on the river
infield
here.
Infield rifle.
And these are weapons are on the river and they are pointed, I promise
HMS
you.
HMS Belfast.
HMS Belfast is the answer, which is a World War II ship and it has guns. Yep. It's the only one with these guns, working guns. There they are. And they are pointed at Scratchwood. If you go on board as a tourist, which you can, it actually tells you there's a sign saying he's pointed at the Scratchwood.
Oh, God, I would so love to fire it. I would so, so love to fire.
Come on.
That's another weird... Do you want to know, you may know this. It's just a weird World War II ship story as well. This is a US ship. It was known as the luckiest ship in the US Navy in the 1940s because it was the only ship that was utterly unscarred at Pearl Harbor. It was called the USS Phoenix. It was sunk in 1982, but it had changed its name. Do you know what to?
HMS Belfast.
It's named after a person, person of military rank. It had been sold to another country and named after General...
Belgrano.
General Belgrano. It was sunk by the British. It remains the only warship ship ever sunk by a nuclear submarine. And it was sunk with most hands lost.
Over 300 people.
Over 300 people, yeah. But that was known as the luckiest ship in the USS Navy. That's an extraordinary history for that boat. You always want to make a movie about it. It's just bizarre, isn't it?
Well, I never knew that.
So, HMS Belfast may be docked in the City of London, but its guns are trained on Scratchwood service station, so it looks like those bankers are for the high jump. And talking of the high jump, this leads me to my next question. Why did Fosbury flop?
Gravity.
Why did he choose to flop? That's the Fosbury flop.
Well,
what is it?
The people previously would jump forwards over the bar and land in a sandpit, and he jumped backwards over and landed on a big dirigible.
That's right. These are the previous ones. They're the scissors, the eastern cut-off.
Yeah, the western roll. That
western
was all the
roll. Range. The straddle. In 1968, old Fosbury appeared with this new move, and he won the Olympic gold. And now every high jumper does it. And no one will ever go back to any other way of doing it. But there's a reason why it's so efficient, why it works so well.
It might be that in the other ones, you have to get all of yourself at that height at the same moment, whereas he kind of took himself a bit at a time.
You're sort of right. It's where your centre of gravity is. And on the Fosbury flop, your centre of gravity is actually under the bar. And on the other ones, it's wherever. That's a dotted line there. That indicates the centre of gravity is that sort of, you know, hazard symbol.
He's just realised there's no thing to land on.
Well, that's the other thing, of course. The other thing about the Fosbury flop is it did require a move from sand to little nice rubber cushiony things. Mm. Yeah. If you do the scissors one, which we saw, that sort of stepping one over there, your centre of gravity passes 30 centimetres over the bar. So what it means, having a lower centre of gravity, is you get extra height in exchange for no extra effort. Mm. And also, these records stay for a long time. The male one was set in 93 and the female in 87, and they still stand. So it looks as if we're reaching the limits of how
we're reaching, because
high
gravity's getting stronger and stronger.
Well, that could easily be... and long jumps, too. They stay for a long time, don't they?
Yeah.
Who held the world long jump record from 1935 to 1960?
Not Jesse Owens.
It was Jesse Owens. What? So you're wrong by saying it's not Jesse Owens. You get the point for that. Yeah.
Is there a limbo competition to sort of, like, counteract?
That would be a good idea. I wonder what the limbo...
Olympic limbo.
Yeah.
Should be.
Yeah, I love the limbo.
And are you allowed to sort of flatten your nipples, for example? You snip them off.
With duct tape.
And you tape them down. I lost it. I lost a limbo dancing.
I thought you were going to say you lost a
nipple. I lost a nipple.
It was a razor blade. Yeah. Oh. We were playing in prison.
Russian limbo. You lost the limbo competition.
I lost.
You amaze me.
I know.
Someone got lower than you.
Somebody got lower. Can you imagine that? Someone more limber than me.
Oh. Good
it was. It was actually Lionel Blair.
Obviously a dream. Well, no. Me and Lionel Blair were having a limbo competition. One of my nipples fell off.
Yeah, yeah. That's right. I'd had a bit of blue cheese before I went to bed. It was for charity. It was a charitable limbo dancing competition. It was me, Sunita, and Lionel Blair.
Surely Sunita cleaned up.
No, you'd think, wouldn't you? You'd think Sunita, Lionel, and me. No. Lionel. I was third, Sunita, but Lionel.
Well, he's a dancer to his fingertips.
He's limber.
Yeah, but he's also about 70 years old.
Yeah, but he's limber.
Anyway, yes. No. So, the revolutionary thing about Dick Fosbury's flop was that it allows your centre of gravity to pass under the bar in innovation, which means that current world records are likely to stand forever. And so, to a matter of the utmost gravity, the dead weight of general ignorance, fingers on buzzers, if you please. Hallelujah, it's raining wine. Now, how big would a cloud need to be, right, in order to dispense for me my recommended daily limit of wine?
12 stone, 4 ounces.
Does not compute. Damn. That's your answer, isn't it?
Yes, I know.
Okay.
All right. Size of a car. A car.
Well, oddly enough, you're strangely using the same metaphor that we are. We're using a form of transport, but
a VW bus
is the right answer. About the size of a bus, a wine cloud would weep the same amount of water that would match 250 millilitres, which is your recommended daily allowance of wine. Come from a cloud. But this recommended daily allowance business is very interesting. In Britain, it's 21 units, whatever that means, a week, I think. In Poland, it's 12 and a half units. It's a tiny amount. But in Canada, it's 23 and three quarters. In America, 24 and a half. South Africa and Denmark, 31.5. And guess where it's 35, Barry?
Australia.
Australia fair. Yeah. But our limit is 21. There's a study that found that if you drank between 21 and 30, you would belong to a group of people that had the lowest mortality rate in Britain. So, in other words, we're being recommended to drink too little alcohol for our health. In fact, it's been worked out you'd have to drink 63 units a week or a bottle of wine a day to face the same death risk as a teetotaler.
Well, I think you'll find that most people are actually making that up themselves, kind of, you know, just instinctively.
Well, the odd thing is, it's the guy who actually came up with it who's admitted they made the number up. They said, well, we had to say something, so we said that.
But is the assumption not that there are other lifestyle factors associated with the sort of person who likes a bit of wine?
Mm. Having an accident is the main problem, obviously, yeah. But nonetheless, just statistically and actuarially, you are likely to live longer if you drink between 21 and 30.
If you're a social animal, you're less stressed.
It may actually be the physical effect of alcohol on the body is actually beneficial in those amounts. Anyway, if clouds were made of wine, you should limit yourself to about a busful a day. Now, an easy one. How many bullets are there in a gunslinger's revolver?
7.
5.
12 stone. 4.
Six. Okay.
Well, six, they're called six guns. Yeah. They have, as you noticed, six chambers.
But there
chambers.
Were six in and one in the spout, isn't that?
No, it's not six. Quite the other way around.
5.
You're right, 5. Why 5?
Gravity. I used to know this, but I've forgotten.
Well, it's simply safety. Wyatt Earp, who one can be regarded as something as an expert, he said, I've often been asked why 5 shots without reloading were all the top-notch gunfighter ever fired with, 5, when his guns were chambered for 6. The answer is safety. The hammer rested on the empty chamber, so it could never discharge by mistake, because there was no safety catch on that. And there, of course, the great Clint Eastwood. I did a thing in America once, and there was an armourer who's the film guy who gives you the gun and everything and takes it away and keeps you safe and gives you blanks or whatever. And he told me a fact. He'd been doing it since the 30s. He'd been working on westerns. He said only 2 actors he ever worked with, and he worked with them all, didn't blink when they fired a gun. This is actually, oddly enough, a shot of Clint exactly proving he was one of them, because there's guns going off and his eyes are open, as much as they ever were. And he was one. He never blinked. John Wayne blinked, you know, Anthony Quinn, Gary Cooper. Who's the other?
Kenneth Williams.
Carry On Cowboy.
Yeah.
Yes, it goes wide open. the idea of those butch American armourers called Rusty and Randy, whatever, having heard of Kenneth Williams. It was your own guy, Kenneth.
Goddamn Williams.
No.
Bravest guy I ever
knew. Actually, Westworld is probably the Western most people would think of. Yul Brynner, yeah. Mm. Yul Brynner never blunk. So, anyway, the answer is they have 5 bullets, not 6. So, to gravy. You know when you're cooking a steak and all that red juice flows out, that red liquid? What is it?
Blood.
Blood. Oh! Oddly enough, it isn't. You'd think it was, wouldn't you? But it's not. It's another proteinous substance. Not hemoglobin, but in fact something called myoglobin. Yeah. It's the thing that's used to operate the muscles, but it isn't actually the blood that's coming out there.
It's not anything to do with blood, then?
As I say, it's called myoglobin.
Is it artificial colouring material?
Nor is it artificial, it's real. You see, the two have distinct functions. When muscles are used for short, fast bursts of energy, glucose from the blood provides the fuel. For sustained activity, this stuff, myoglobin, is used to oxidise the fat, and that provides the energy.
I didn't realise this programme was so educational.
Yeah? Oh,
a lot that's of it's our made promise. Up, a lot of it's lies.
Not the bullets that I know it seems by. Absolutely.
I'm going to test that out tonight.
How would it be?
Yeah, so it's no brother. I don't know what it is. If you put it in the gravy, and if you put it in gravy, you get
gravity.
Gravity, exactly. So we go from gravity trains to the gravy train, and the circle is complete.
What's happening?
For the scores, ladies and gentlemen. Oh, I say, this is really interesting. We have a tie for the lead, ladies and gentlemen. Huh? Rich and Alan at plus three.
Plus three.
Yes, plus three. In third place, with minus 8, Bill Bailey. Failing to defy gravity the way Rich and Alan did and sinking like a stone, I fear. However, what a welcome and gorgeous pebble. Wow. What a shining, lustrous, gorgeous stone. At minus 36, Barry Humphries. Well, that's your lot from QI. My thanks to Barry, Rich, Bill, Alan. And I leave you with one last interesting thing about gravity. You know, in the early days of television, it was widely believed that television sets weighed more when they were switched on. And the main reason for this belief apparently came from reading the manufacturer's instructions, which warned people always to switch off their sets before attempting to move them. Good night. Thank you.
Siler and Matt locked in their head-to-head with Brand New Heroes next here on BBC Two. Or there's more comedy from the excellent Armstrong and Miller on BBC Four now.